Hello everybody. So we are going to continue with the second part of beta blockers. And in this discussion, we are going to mainly concentrate on the cardioselective beta blockers. We'll be learning the mechanism of action, actions, advantages over the non-selective beta blockers, their drawbacks and their uses. And we'll also look into some relevant pharmacology of the alpha plus beta blockers. Now, the examples I have already discussed in the previous part under the classification. Once again, I'll repeat it here. That is, without intrinsic sympathomimetic activity, metoprolol, atenolol, bisoprolol, esmolol, bichaxolol, nebivolol. You have to learn these examples by heart. Then with intrinsic sympathomimetic activity, examples are celiprolol and acebutolol. These are the examples of cardioselective beta blockers. Then comes the mechanism of action. So I already discussed that in the previous slide that these drugs are more potent in blocking the beta 1 receptors and than the beta 2 receptors. It doesn't mean that they do not block the beta 2 receptors, but they are more selective on the beta 1 receptors. The actions will be on the heart because their action is mainly on the beta 1 receptor, and it's the same actions that we have learned under the non-selective beta blockers. That is, they inhibit the increase in the heart rate, contractility, conduction velocity. Then they decrease the cardiac output, reduce the cardiac work and oxygen consumption, reduce the automaticity of the heart, reduces the BP by reducing the cardiac output. So they do not have any action on the blood vessels because on the blood vessels, you have got the beta 2 receptors. They are, so hence they are not causing any vasodilatation on the, or the blocking of the vasodilatation just like the beta block, non-selective beta blockers. They are blocking the beta 1 receptors, bringing about a fall in the cardiac output, and hence they will decrease the blood pressure. So the main, their effect on the blood pressure is mainly because of the decrease in the cardiac output. So right from the beginning itself, you will see a fall in the BP with the use of cardioselective beta blockers. On the other hand, in the case of non-selective beta blockers, I already told you they bring about a fall in the BP much later, after a chronic administration only. Now, the advantages over non-selective beta blockers, they are safer for control of hypertension in asthmatics. So, the non-selective beta blockers, they cannot be used in asthmatics because they can cause bronchoconstriction. Now, if you have a patient who is having hypertension and bronchial asthma, you would prefer to use a cardioselective beta blocker to control the hypertension. You cannot use a non-selective beta blocker in such a patient because if you use that to control the blood pressure, his asthma will get aggravated. So you have to make a rational choice. And the choice in such patients who are having hypertension and asthma is to use a cardioselective beta blocker. Again, they are safer for use in diabetics because they do not interfere with the carbohydrate metabolism or the glycogenolysis that occurs during hyperglycemia, because these are actions which are mediated through the beta 2 receptors. Since these drugs do not have much of an action on the beta 2 receptors, they are not interfering with these actions. Then there are lower incidences of precipitating peripheral vascular disease. There is less deterioration of the lipid profile, and there is less impairment of the exercise capacity with their uses, because all these conditions or these instances are occurring because of the blockade of the beta 2 receptors. Now, that is not happening with the case of cardioselective beta blockers. So, we have an advantage over non-selective beta blockers in these conditions. So, if a hypertensive is there with PVD, then you can go for cardioselective beta blocker, just like you can use them in patients who have hypertensive patients who are having a concurrent asthma also. Now, what are the drawbacks? they are ineffective in suppressing essential tremor. The essential tremor is something which is mediated through beta 2 receptor. Now, by blocking beta 2 receptors, only you can have a therapeutic effect in essential tremor. That cannot be achieved with cardioselective beta blockers, because the cardioselective beta blockers are mainly blocking the beta 1 and not have much of an effect on the beta 2 receptor. Again, rebound hypertension, that is not being that doesn't improve even with the cardioselective beta blocker. That means if you are using a cardioselective beta blocker and then you suddenly withdraw, you will still have a rebound hypertension just like that you had in case of non-selective beta blockers. Now, the uses are mainly cardiac uses, because obviously the non-cardiac uses in that we saw in the non-selective beta blockers were because of the blockade of the beta 2. Now, the cardiac, that is why they are not there under the uses of the cardioselective beta blockers. So, the uses are in hypertension, angina pectoris, myocardial infarction, and cardiac arrhythmias mainly. And under the angina pectoris, you can see that they can be used both in classical as well as the variant angina, which is not seen in the case of non-selective beta blockers. I have mentioned that they cannot be used in variant or vasospastic angina. Now we'll just have a look at the important cardioselective blockers. We'll just see the prominent features or some of the important pharmacokinetic features. So metoprolol and the S-metoprolol, they are considered to be the prototype of the cardioselective beta blockers. Now, we mentioned propranolol as the prototype of the non-selective beta blockers. This is a prototype of the cardioselective beta blockers. The first pass metabolism is less than propranolol with this drug, and the individuals can be fast or slow metabolizers of metoprolol. There's some kind of genetic variation which is seen with the metabolism of metoprolol. And this drug will not cause significant bradycardia. It does decrease the heart rate because of the blockade of the beta 1, but significant bradycardia for some reason is not seen with the metoprolol. It can be given orally as well as IV, and IV is the preferred route in myocardial infarction. Its dose is 12.5 to 50 milligrams OD or BD. OD means once daily, BD means twice daily. Atenolol and the same, the S-enantiomer atenolol, it doesn't show significant first-pass metabolism. The characteristic advantage of this drug is it has got a low lipid solubility, and hence it will not cross the CNS and doesn't produce much of a CNS side effects like forgetfulness and all will not be seen much with the use of this drug. It has got a longer duration of action, and once daily dose is just enough. And this is one of the very popular antihypertensive drug, atenolol. And it can be used for hypertension, angina, though it is not much approved for the use in congestive heart failure. The route is oral, 12.5 to 50 milligram once daily. Then you have got acebutolol, which is having additional partial agonistic and membrane stabilizing property. It is rapidly metabolized to an active metabolite, and this active metabolite again increases its T-half. So only a single daily dose is required. The first pass metabolism is less than propranolol, and again, like metoprolol, they can be fast or slow metabolizers in this case also. Now, this is just by mistake, it is written metoprolol, but it is acebutolol. And the route is oral or IV for arrhythmias. Bisoprolol is another cardioselective beta blocker, which can be used for hypertension, angina, congestive heart failure, and single dose per day is needed. Then S-malol is the ultra short acting cardioselective beta blocker. And why it is ultra short active is because it is metabolized in the blood itself. It is inactivated by the esterases in the blood itself. The T-half is less than 10 minutes and the duration of action is 15 to 20 minutes. The duration is 15 to 20 minutes. It is not a very long acting drug. And the use is mainly for emergency control of arrhythmias. And some arrhythmias which can occur are atrial fibrillation, supraventricular tachycardia, and arrhythmias during anesthesia, arrhythmias occurring during early myocardial infarction. These are all arrhythmias. and controlling the it is also used for controlling blood pressure and heart rate during and after cardiac surgery. So it is only used for emergency control of arrhythmias and hypertension because of its short action. Then you have got celiprolol. This is having an additional weak beta 2 agonistic action. Okay, so it's not a purely, it is blocking beta 1. At the same time, it is having an agonistic action on the beta 2 receptor. So this can be safe in asthmatics. That is because it causes bronchodilation. It has got additional nitric oxide donor property. So it can cause an additional vasodilatation, and this can also add to antihypertensive action. So it is having an NO donor action, and it's also having an additional beta 2 agonistic action. Similarly, nebivolol also is a nitric oxide donor. This is an additional action. It also improves the endothelial function and delays atherosclerosis. It increases the insulin sensitivity also. Is used for hypertension and congestive heart failure. So you can see these are all some of the additional properties of cardioselective beta blockers that you are seeing in celiprolol and in nebivolol. Now we'll have a look at the alpha plus beta blockers. And under this, we have two examples, that is lebetalol and carbidolol. First, we'll see the lebetalol. So lebetalol is the first drug which was developed which could block both the alpha and the beta receptors. And it is found to be more potent in blocking the beta than the alpha receptors. That is why it is included under the classification of the beta blockers. So it is blocking the beta 1, beta 2, as well as the alpha 1. It is also having slightly weak beta 2 agonistic action and direct vasodilating property. These two are the additional activities of the lebetalol. So it is mainly having a action on the fall in BP because of the alpha plus beta blockade as well as the beta 2 agonistic action. All these will contribute to the fall in the BP. It is orally effective, but there is high first pass metabolism. T half is 4 to 5 hours. The ADRs can be excessive fall in BP, and especially on standing up, that is called as postural hypotension, hepatotoxicity, and failure of ejaculation. It is mainly used in hypertension at a dose of 50 milligram twice daily. It's also used for hypertensive emergencies where it is given IV at a dose of 20 milligram every 10 minutes till the response is obtained. For normal hypertension control, you can give it as 50 milligram twice daily orally. But for emergencies, you are using it by the parenteral route. Now, the carbidolol, the mechanism of action is beta 1, beta 2, and alpha 1 blocker, just like we saw in lebetalol. It is also having some additional vasodilating property by blocking the calcium channel and has got additional antioxidant property, that is, it's cardioprotective. So mainly it is used for hypertension, and because of this cardioprotective property, it is also finding a role in congestive cardiac failure. You can see the dose of these are in hypertension, 6.25 milligram twice daily. You can start with that initially, and if the response is not adequate, you can increase the dose up to a maximum of 25 milligram twice daily. Congestive cardiac failure, 3.125 milligram twice daily to 25 milligram twice daily. So these are the discussion on the cardioselective beta blockers and alpha plus beta blockers. So I have mentioned the doses under each of these drugs. So many a times the students come and ask me if they have to read the doses. It is advisable that you read the doses because these are all very, very popular and very commonly used drugs. So it is preferable that you at least become familiar with the doses. And it will always be good for you if you remember the doses, because at the end of the day, you are going to prescribe for the patients. So it is advisable that you learn the doses, if not possible for everything, at least for the important drugs like propranolol. Then you can learn the dose for timolol under the non-selective beta blockers. Then under the cardioselective beta blockers, you can remember the doses of metoprolol, then etinolol, esmolol, carbidolol, and lebetalol. At least these many doses, at least you should learn. Thank you for the patient hearing.